Welcome to 155, a podcast about punk songs. I'm Josiah Hughes.
And I'm Sam Sutherland, and this week we're talking about Inside Out by the band Eve 6. Josiah, why do you sound like you're at a funeral right now?
Because of what you just said.
before we delve into, you know, why my co-host Josiah is just so dejected this week, a bit of housekeeping. Mm-hmm. Josiah, you're dejected because you didn't pick this song and you're used to having full control over your life. Is that pretty much really what it is?
That's the problem is we've now allowed our desperation for Patreon to control us so much that you, dear listener, if you pony up the cash, you can now pick one song every month that we do. And you could make it some fucking meme-ass Bodie McBoatface shit like this week, what we're doing. Or you could make us talk about something good to you that we... I mean, either way, I think definitely knowing what fans are like of things and what kind of community, what democracy does, what voting does, it's always going to be disappointing. But you can disappoint us in some special way every month. If you want.
I like to think that the failings of democracy are also a result of fan culture, which is in many ways true, right?
Yeah, that's true.
Like,
that's
Joe true. Biden might be president because of fan culture, you mm-hmm. know?
That's very so, true. Yeah, I mean, I think basically because of the tone of AV Club TV recaps 15 years ago, the end result is the society we have now. The other housekeeping is,
do you think that is the most dangerous piece of media? Like in terms of like, you know, the fears that have been stoked by like various sort of dangerous films or songs in the past that they would, you know, lead to, you know, the youth gone wild, rampant criminal behavior. But really, AV Club, TV Club reviews, is that the sort of heart of darkness when it comes to contemporary popular culture?
It's one of them. I mean, definitely it's the tone of recaps of seemingly trivial things. Because, I mean, Gamergate is kind of the flip side. But at least those people have some passion.
Yeah, I mean, this whole thing about, like, Gamergate being a portender of things to come, you know, but also were they right? Anyway, this week we're talking about a song I'm not done yet.
It's not just the choosing thing. It's also, you and I have just decided this officially today. I think we hinted before, but on the Patreon episodes, there's extra sections. If you're listening on Patreon this week, we're not giving you the extra section first because you put us into this mess and you have to live with it. But starting next week, we're going to start watching the Tom DeLonge UFO show in the Patreon section.
It's going to be, I'm like legitimately very excited about it because I love Tom DeLonge and I love a UFO.
Yeah. And we've just been putting it off forever, but it's like something I think we kind of need to watch. So we'll start watching that and you'll be able to listen
it's
along.
It's necessary to fill in these holes in our knowledge for sure.
Yeah, exactly. But other than that, oh, and I think you're going to have a movie night soon too on the Discord.
I mean, yeah, so we'll do, I think we got to do, I really want to watch the Germs movie. So same as last time where we watched CBGB, we'll watch What We Do Is Secret, which is the Walk to Remember Darby Crash crossover.
I think the Mei Shi is in that movie, actually, pretending to be screamers or something.
Yeah, sick.
And then the other thing I was going to say,
like in a couple of weeks, we'll do like a Friday night and hang out in Discord and get to know Shane West a little better.
And Discord or Patreon is also where you can find out about the new merch that's up for pre-order because there's still one more week to pre-order the new merch. I'm just going to do it in there because I don't really feel like making an official store, but I also don't want to just open it up to anyone. I'm still doing it kind of the janky DIY way, so that's kind
exclusive
of the happy
drops.
Medium.
That's the thing.
Yeah, exactly. It's exclusive Patreon-only drops. So now please feel free to get into this exciting, air quotes, punk song that we're going to be discussing tonight.
So we debated not even doing the song because it's you know, somehow it is less of a punk song than Good Charlotte's 40-Ounce Dream or Avril Lavigne's What the Hell. Or Nine Inch Nails, March of the Pixies. Like, we've done things that are on the outer edges. This feels edged, but according to Wikipedia, Eve 6 is partially a pop punk band. However, this song on Wikipedia is classified as an alternative rock song. So we're really being quite generous in discussing it this week. Before we get to an inevitable sort of Coney 2012 sort of contemporary meme chat, I actually don't know if you liked this song at all before any of this. Like before we were out here doing the Ice Bucket Challenge.
Yeah. And I mean, and for those not keeping track, what Sam is hinting at or talking around is that this does to us feel like we're being forced to do an episode about Harambe. I mean, I remember when this Twitter account popped off, there was like one day where everyone was like, 2021 win, must follow, Eve 6 guy. And then, of course, all of those people have since unfollowed because it's such an annoying account. And I really do think something has happened in the last week that I don't want to talk about on here, but if you know, you know. I have been thinking once again about separating the art from the artist, because an artist I previously loved was kind of indirectly outed for some really sketchy shit. So I've been thinking about separating the art from the artist. I don't really think that I personally can do it, because these so many artists that I love, their persona is part of the art, and it's too difficult to do. So that's one thing that we're not going to talk about in this episode. But one thing I do want to talk about in a bit is, can you separate the art from the posts? And I don't think you can in this case.
Well, Nir Tanden would, in a very recent turn of events, if you were listening to this podcast on the day we recorded it, this would be relevant news, discovering exactly that. She has, as an artist of policy, not been allowed to be separated from her post. This raises big questions.
But like, other than the fact that kind of the Eve 6 Twitter account and the discourse around the Eve 6 Twitter account genuinely does make me want to die, I gotta say, and I've admitted all the shit that I liked that was embarrassing, I've admitted all my flaws, I've always found this song to be really, really embarrassing and annoying and just like irritating as fuck. So I've never liked it at all.
So you there was never like even a time in your life where you felt sort of your heart open to the Eve 6 experience?
No, like in, so this song is what, 98, is that right?
98, yeah.
So I was 13. I don't know.
Yeah, well, exactly. Did you like cooler things when you were 13?
I definitely liked some cooler things. I mean, but I also think this was peak. And also, you can hear the loud wind blowing, can't you, of this Montreal evening? Because I know it's a haunted, like, haunted night.
You're recording it like in your ice fishing hut.
I've decided to reconnect with nature because I knew this was coming. I guess I was like taping songs off the radio back then. I certainly liked some cheesy songs, like I think I associate this song with like Tonic. If she could only see.
That I see song? It as being closer to like the sort of pop punk end of that 90s, like late 90s alt rock, like sort of spectrum. So more like a Lit, like more like My Own Worst Enemy, more like maybe an SR-71 if you wanted to go.
Right. Or it's obviously like it has the verboseness of Third Eye Blind, or even of like, I was thinking something. I feel like this song is trying to be Two Princes, but in like a pop punk way. Yeah.
Why were all these like young people in the 90s doing bands that were like Eminem, pop punk, scat? Like why were they all doing that? Because you're right, like this Third Eye Blind, very verbose.
Or is it trying to be the Chili's, I guess, maybe?
Oh, that's, you think it's the influence of the
Either Chili way, boys. There's just something about this song that is like the verboseness doesn't really work for me. There's something about it that just seems, I don't know a better word, just like very douchey. Like I prefer, you know, Blink-182, like they sound like they're just fucking failure nerds. But this seems like a guy who's like, he's like, seems like a jock who's trying to show you that he could also be in the Spin Doctors if he wanted to. And then you're kind of like, but no one was asking anyone to ever prove this kind of scenario. You know what I mean?
Like, I mean, I don't know, millions of people, right? You know,
yeah, and then there's just something about the lyrics. I don't like I don't like the word rind, first of all, and then every sort of stanza feels, or every line of every stanza feels like it ends with something that sounds like the word rind, or like rang. It has this kind of like It kind of has the what's that viral video of that lady from Little Mix doing a Jamaican accent impression where she's, do you know what I'm talking about? It's right. So good. It kind of it has the this song has that enunciation to it. And I think that, like, it's one of those things where I'll talk more about the internet culture around it in a second, but yeah, there's just something about it that it kind of grosses me out. And it also kind of it reminds me of the Stone Temple Pilots, who I never liked. It's kind of, to me, sounds like that kind of like stanky, funky pop song. And then it also kind of reminds me of the Newsboys, the Australian Christian rock band.
Oh, wow.
Which, like,
compliment from you.
What's that? Yeah, I know. That's the thing. But, like, I feel like if I'm going to listen to music this embarrassing and corny, then it should be Christian. You know what I mean? Like,
is this? Yeah.
The lyrics are like, Isabella was a, or Isabella was a belly dancer. This is so
great.
Good.
Great hit.
Cool video too.
I know.
Long intro. So,
Is the U6 guy not? Oh wow! Is he not Christian? Like, is he just,
who's that?
Sober, the guy from U6.
I thought that you would know. I don't think so.
I'm not.
Probably like, he's the kind of guy who like reads every explainer about every Twitter trend. So he's probably like, I'm trad cast or something. He's like, and that's, oh, this is way better than U6.
Oh, yeah, I wish that, like, this was secular music, because I'm not going to start listening to this now, but imagining, like, getting drunk at a party and putting this on and singing along to it.
Sick, right?
Like, hold that on. Actually sounds I need super
to
fun.
I need to show you a different one real quick. I need to... Am I wrong that it's a little bit similar?
It's absolutely similar. I can totally see what you're saying.
Okay, the song is, like...
I feel like I only knew the Newsboys' name because they were like it was like them and Jars of Clay. I feel like were like the big Christian bands.
But pre Blink-182, the drummer of the Newsboys like had a flying drum kit in all the stadiums. So this song is about how, like, if you're not a Christian and you end up going to hell, you don't get to have, they don't serve breakfast in hell. And so the whole song is just like about like breakfast. Called Breakfast. The chorus is huge, though.
Great song on the Old Steady record called Unpleasant Breakfast. That's also about breakfast, Josiah. Maybe you should check out this
band. See, that's what I'm saying. All these bands that you like just sound like the Newsboys.
Yeah, no,
all the milk has turned and Captain Crunch is waving farewell. When the big one finds you, may the song remind you that they don't serve breakfast in hell. Oh, yes.
See, that doesn't sound especially Christian to me, even though it literally mentions hell.
Also, it's they're Australian, too. Adding it. So basically, EVE6 to me sounds like EVE6 to me sounds like a less cool version of an Australian contemporary Christian rock band from the 90s.
Okay, I mean, that, like, based on what you just played for me, though, that sounds like a huge compliment.
No. Like, the Newsboys really suck. I never liked the Newsboys, to be honest with you, but they're
take
funny.
Me to your leader.
Yeah, I mean, it's funny. It's just, like, funny, disgusting music is what both of these things are. So, no, I never liked it, and it's weird to me that they were presented as pop punk, but here's kind of the smoking gun, actually, that I kind of knew via Pod Magic that this episode was going to happen. My friend PJ from Calgary, when we started Gobbuary, and kind of I've been whining about the EVE6 Twitter account for a few months because it specifically irks me in such a way that could only be irksome to me.
It's fine.
I'm gonna freak out in a second. I'm gonna, like, all of our dirty laundry is about to be aired on this one. All the people that Sam has pretended not to dislike all this time, it's all coming out.
Oh shit.
No, but you know, I've been railing about it for a while. My friend PJ was like, I actually saw EVE6 and Treble Charger at the Palace in 2000, which is, I guess, a Calgary venue. And the opener was the singer of EVE6 wearing a shirt of who opened, and it was Gob. So there's a picture of the guy from E6 wearing a Gob shirt. And as soon as I saw this picture in January, I was like, fuck, it's going to happen. I think I just knew. It was one of those things. It's like a Final Destination thing. Oh, my God.
Yeah, this is full on Final Destination. there was no way that we were ever not going to do this song. Wow, does Free Will even exist?
No, this is like proof of no predestination.
Fate but what Eve 6 makes for us? I don't want to live in that world.
I know, me neither. But we're stuck here.
Jesus Christ! All right, well that's a cool photo. That'll be a good one for the socials. That's a good post.
I didn't ask PJ if I could post it, so I guess we'll see. Or maybe we'll have to get a campaign going. I mean, let's just be epic and viral on Twitter now all the time.
I'm ready for it.
But you love this band.
Well, okay, I do.
The thing now is that's interesting is you know that I don't like it and I'm mad about this, but you also like the band and you also know that probably there's a chance this guy will listen to it because he's clearly Googles himself constantly. So there's all these like interesting things
there's a lot of factors.
Where will Sam land right now? Because you have to choose a path.
100%. But I'm going to try to dance between the raindrops here. Okay. So the first Eve 6 album fucking rocks. It's like a great kind of like alternative rock pop punk album. Wikipedia has summarized its genres quite effectively. We talked a lot about Snow Job in the Gob episode. I think we talked a little bit about Eve 6 playing a really insanely sick and also very legendary in my mind as a high school student at the time. Snow Job performance, which I had a friend who took the VHS and like dubbed them on a tape so we could listen to it. Like I really, really liked that record. Didn't really continue onto the second record outside of Promise, which is a big time jam.
But the first record is the one with this song on it.
Inside Out. Okay. Yeah. That's the one with this on it. And there's like a few Eve 6 songs that I will throw on, like just play those from time to time. If I think of them, I'll be like, oh yeah, going to put Open Road Song onto something when I'm going on a nice long drive, you know? And when that comes on, I'm rocking. It's a great time. I love to rock when I'm driving. So that is sick. And I'd say there's like a better than good chance that like if Junior Battles stayed over your house after a show and you like hinted that you wanted to party and you had a stereo and there was like a way for us to control it, within the first hour, we would probably play this song because like this is a very fun song to me to sing along to at like 2 a.m., like 4 a.m. at someone's house. Watching the video and listening to it before we did this episode is probably the first time I've heard the song Inside Out. Not other songs from that Eve 6 record, but like this song sober probably since I was in grade 8. Like this is – I was like, this is what the song sounds like?
It's way smaller than I've remembered it being because it has so many stops.
And slow. Like really fucking dunk. And what you were saying about it feeling gross, like – that's sort of what I was hearing this time. It was like a do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do- not at all like that's not at the forefront of what's happening there. But yeah, between the like sort of like Scooby-Doo-Dat vocal delivery,
there's even I actually just made some notes.
Funkiness.
I made some notes before we talked, and I wrote even the hi hats are disgusting because there's some hi hat. Even the hi hats are trying to like get some more syllables in there to show.
Yeah, and there's so much of the
yeah.
And again, that shit. If you're like not fully yourself at 4 a.m. and you get to the like through with you part and the drums are like you can like be waving your arms like you're air drumming and it's like insanely fucking
can
fun.
I just say the cutest thing in the world is that your description of Junior Battles after a show, you're like, if there's even a hint that you're down to party, which like anyone else saying that genuinely means doing cocaine together, but your version is like going down a trip down memory lane on YouTube.
Yeah. It's just like, we are going to be listening to Meredith Brooks. We are going to be listening to Thought Out Loud.
You're
going
to
be listening to Eve 6.
Tapping your nose. Like, you got any party favors? And then someone else, Aaron Zorko is like, he's talking about AirPlay on your TV. Can we get your AirPlay code?
Yeah. I can smell the hits. I can smell the hits from the late 90s. It is. It's true. We're horrible if that's not what you think partying is. It's probably been a real, in retrospect, letdown for certain people. But we're like, how much do you want to listen to the entire first side of Jagged Little Pill? I hope it's the answer is
We should order a pizza. Look, thank you for hosting us. I know that you said your cheat day on your diet is Sunday, but let's order a pizza.
Well, I will say, like, as a small digression, there was a time, and we have certainly been, like, unwelcome and terrible guests at people's houses, but this was always my perception, is that we, like, showed up and were, like, too loud and made everyone listen to My Own Worst Enemy too many times. And then, like, at one point we were told that, like, by several people in one sort of specific region, it was like, oh, no, everyone talked about you were, like, the best house guest they've ever had. And it was, like, because we, like, would tie up our, like, 300 empty beers in plastic bags before we left and take them with us, I think, and, like, not try to get cocaine off of everyone. So that's a story about how I'm fun to party with, and I think people like me. But this song as it exists, I think, like, as a memory, you know, like, as a fully just, like, crystallized piece of nostalgia, I actually think it's, like, a one of the untouchable songs from this era. Like, I would have put, as a memory, Eve Six's Inside Out next to Semi-Charm Life and My Own Worst Enemy, and even, like, What's My Age Again. Like, I think it's sort of it sits in that, like, oh, I'm watching a teen movie, like, that's just that energy. And in terms of how it makes you feel at this age, at, like, a certain time of night, you know?
It's weird how it feels like a novelty song, kind of, but it's not. Like, is it a novelty song or is it not? I feel like it took the magic of Semi-Charm Kind of Life and then kind of made it more of a novelty in a way.
You got to talk a little bit more. Something went down the wrong tube there.
Oh, what happened? What are you sipping on? Sam's in party mode again.
Yeah, I was too excited. I was like, I got something to say about that. And then just, like, inhaled a bunch of liquid into my lungs. I'm good now. They were so much younger than those bands. And I genuinely wonder how much of it is that, because, like, obviously we saw a lot of it in terms of, like, the kind of Twitter jokes and stuff. But like, the reality is this is a song written by a 16-year-old.
Is that, like, true? That's how old this guy was? Yeah. I don't know anything about this fucking guy. I don't care. But, like,
they were 18 when the album came out or whatever. But basically, like, you know, actually, he's like, I wrote this song when I was 16.
That's what it reminds me of. It kind of reminds me of M-bop in a way, but much worse. Oh,
totally. Yeah. It has that, like, really, or like the early Moffat songs. Like, I genuinely think there's this, like, way, because I think fundamentally, like, what you've got here is, like, there's no doubt it's a fucking good song. Like, it connected with a lot of people, and like, that means something.
But I guess to me, like the magic, the secret ingredient, as much as I love to roast it and make fun of it, the secret ingredient of what I consider to be punk is some degree of either just being or being aware of or intentionally railing against the concept of coolness. And this song seems entirely oblivious to the concept of coolness, which is why it sounds like Christian rock and bop to me, because it's just like some goofy 16-year-olds playing syncopated drum beats and goofing around.
Well, and I think, like, part of the problem is a little bit that, so there's a song written by a 16-year-old and it sounds like that, and, like, you know, again, when I thought the Eve Six Can was funny, which I did, and I tweeted, like, oh, like, OMG, you, sir. Like,
did that you delete was totally it? Let's my see. Vibe. Let's see what you tweeted.
No, I never tweeted anything, but I retweeted one of the tweets, like, in the first, like, week, you know, when it was, like, new and exciting and you were already over it. I was like, this is fucking funny. Like, I really thought it was funny. I actually think we should put off talking about the internet side of it, because it's even in trying to, like,
I mean, I have something I want to say. Go ahead.
You know, you can say it. I've ceded the stage to you.
Well, first of all, I just searched, and you did tweet about this song 10 years ago in 2011.
So did you.
I did? Oh, did you search?
Don't think I didn't do this.
Oh, wow. Well,
of course I did.
Whoa. Oh, no. What did I say? Well, you said heinous day of moving heavy stuff, car trouble, Boyd. How do you say that out loud?
Boyd. This is a brutal tweet, but I will say, like,
by genius CFNY. What's CFNY?
That's the edge, which you refer to as CFNY if you want people to think that you're like cool, even though it was never called that during our era.
Decision to play Inside Out by Eve6. That first record, solid gold, is what you said. And you used Uber Social for BlackBerry. Was that some sort of like tweet deck type of thing?
Yeah, no, that was just like there wasn't like a native Twitter app, I think, for BlackBerry. That was just like the Twitter app for BlackBerry. And so you tweeted. So that tweet from me is from July 25th, 2011. On August 11th, August 11th.
Oh, yeah, okay. I see this.
2010. You tweeted not – this is less embarrassing because you don't say genius decision. And anyway, this is – but it's confusing. You just wrote – Sarah and I just listened to The Flies, Eve6, Stroke 9, Fastball, Everclear, Kelly Offsport, and The Offspring, and so much more.
What's Stroke 9?
Stroke 9 was how many people want to kick some ass. I do.
See, this is right? This was tweeted at, I don't know it. This is 12 a.m. I think we were just kind of watching. I mean, that's the thing. Like, sure, the Eve6 as like a, oh, remember. I mean, it's just remember the 90s. Is what it is. Yeah, and 11 years ago, we must have been like, oh, well, we have Vivo on our TV and we can watch all these videos that remind us of trying to win tickets on the radio to see fucking My Mother Earth or whatever. You know, like it's just that kind of it's just that kind of thing. I definitely was pretty neutral in here. So I wish you could have got me, to be honest. But
I know it was just, but also I will say this in terms of getting you, Little Black Backpack. That was another, big Stroke 9.
Oh,
jam.
That sounds familiar.
Little Black Backpack was like the hit before. And then Kick Some Ass was like the big hit. And of course that's prominently featured in Jay and Silent Bob Strike Back. But you did misspell The Flies. Like you
I just noticed that. Yeah, that's.
F-L-I, but of course, now as a seasoned music journalist, you do know that it's F-L-Y-S. And that's the thing is, I think like this song probably belongs more in the category of Got You Where I Want You, which is like Got You Where I Want You is an incredible song that I think more people should respect and like, you know,
but what, okay,
show deference to and like canonize. But instead, Inside Out, and especially as well, this Twitter account sits in a it's punching above its weight. Like it's not as good as The Way. It's not like I'm just looking at your tweet here. Fastball, The Way, one of the best songs of an era. Everclear, Santa Monica, Everything to Everyone. I mean, come on, Kelly Osbourne. Okay, I'm not sure. Offspring, like Eve6 belong between Stroke 9 and The Flies. They just don't really belong between like Third Eye Blind and Lit.
Here's what I think.
That's the mistake.
Here's what I think. I think the magic of this song for the people who liked it is this wonderful feeling that probably could have only happened 10 years ago when you go to the back of your mind and then you remember a song and then it brings you back to like the color of backpack you had. Or I'm saying that because you just mentioned a song. Yeah. About that. But you know, it brings you back to like.
No, totally.
Walking down the hallway of school or whatever. It brings you back to something and you're like, damn, that's funny. And I have a nice memory of the song. Now I'm never going to think about it again. And that's fine. But instead, so that's one feeling of nostalgia that I used to like and something that we've obviously mined in for the last 4 years. And then I also loved like kind of being really annoying and obnoxious and stupid on Twitter. And I also loved talking shit about, like, just hearing musicians talk shit about each other is always like an endlessly fun thing. And so,
yeah.
But for this guy to, like, whether it was on purpose or not, but the fact that he's crystallized it all as one kind of account that everyone loves so much and then says to me that I'm jealous for finding it annoying. It just like makes me want to rip my fucking hair out because it's just like, I don't know how to, it's like the,
I get it in that context. I really,
it's like, it's just all the things that I used to love and me realizing that they're over essentially like, okay, too many people have gotten into this. It's just going to be, it's like, it's not even that it's like, I'm just trying to jump ship on things because they're getting too cool. But it's like, for example, when we go on Twitch, there's so many people talking at once that eventually it just becomes white noise. Whereas similarly, like being into like quote unquote shit posting or whatever, that's, it's just like, it's ruined now. And that's already an embarrassing thing to say out loud, but Yeah. I don't know. Just all these things that I used to like are kind of like, they've now kind of graduated into being normie culture, and it's not interesting to me anymore because I do enjoy things as they're bubbling up rather than once they get to the mall level, other than mall punk, which I think is perfect.
Like, to think about how, I think in particular, because this is a podcast about both of our opinions, like how people specifically exactly like you and I kind of process, I think, some of those inherent contradictions, right? Like being fans of like really like big, like, or appreciating like really big glossy pop culture, you know, but also still like prizing certain types of experiences that hypothetically run like counter to that, but don't, you know, it's not like they have to exist in opposition to them. And then this idea of, is it or is it not pretentious to not like something as much when all of a sudden it's like popular? And, you know, in a, just like a very direct, like to Inside Out sort of comparison, I think about how like I felt about Africa becoming like a meme where, like, for like the first couple of years of Junior Battles, we cover Africa, like, oh, like Africa, big jam. And then all of a sudden it's like a go-to internet meme that gets the point of the Weezer joke. And then I'm like, I never want to hear Africa again. Like, it's just like, it's not special. And what am I mad about that? Like, everyone discovered that an already popular song was good. Like, more people discovered that a popular song is good. But I think there's like a certain element of like, when you're into like punk culture, for lack of a better, more like nuanced term, like part of what you're attracted to is the idea of like sharing more intimate connections with people, and that like that is really meaningful. And so like you could have the sort of like larger cultural conversations and connections with people through like big tent pop culture things that you're not so pretentious that you can't appreciate. But the idea of those things kind of crossing over can, I think, create a dissonance that then is like sort of disappointing, because part of what you maybe prized about a thing was the way it created like in-group language and culture, which is like literally just valuable to us on a social level, right?
I also think that it's like kind of good to be pretentious or elitist about some things, or to have like a backbone of something that goes beyond just being a fucking normie, like, you know, pop culture consumer passively. And I think what was interesting 5 years ago, even as we've been doing this podcast, I felt like it was becoming less and less interesting. What I thought was interesting 5 years ago was to say Blink-182 is better than the Arcade Fire or whatever it might have been, and like kind of see the reaction that I got out of people, but also be willing to follow through and fully argue it 100%. But now that has just become kind of the normal go-to statement, and to the point where like even having any hot take about music is as embarrassing as saying a hot dog is a sandwich now. So it's kind of like, I don't know, it's just kind of like weird. It's almost like it's one of those like trends where I'm like, I literally feel like I'm too old for this, to engage with this. And then also because it's my job to like aggregate internet culture, to see it be like so epically viral all the time. And people are like, it's so epic. He keeps saying libs, or like, you know, he's like also like using Bernie talk all the time. And he likes like some of the fucking leftist podcast type people or whatever. It's just like so embarrassing to me. It's just all, it's way too much.
I get it. I think it would sort of be fine. Like, you know, I was talking about doing this song with Ashley before we started, and we were talking about the Twitter account, and that I thought it was like fucking hilarious. Like, I thought, like, again, I want to make this very clear. I thought it was so fucking funny. I didn't tweet about it, but I retweeted it. I like messaged it to people because I was like, this is fucking funny. And I feel like right out of the gate, I was like, something about this is not going to work for you. But I know I sent it to like other mutuals that we have, where I was like, this guy's just tweeting at famous people asking if they like the song. And I think the issue is like, I think that period of time was like legitimately really funny. And I think there was like, especially this idea of like, how would you feel being like someone in their 40s who's like most like they're you're still kind of famous, because like a cohort of people all just know this song. Like that's really fucking wild. But it's a song you wrote when you were 16. You probably think many of the same things about it that we think about it. Like, even I don't even want to leave the musical conversation because I do think that, like, if they had been paired with a better producer, like you're a different, more quote unquote punk producer, because this got produced by Don Gilmore, who basically became famous for doing Linkin Park. But that's like sort of what he does. It's like that.
I don't think it's just the production.
Imagine if it was like Jerry, but even like it's not like the engineering. I think it's like the production. I was trying to find something like interesting to say about the song, like just from a fucking historical standpoint. You and I agree that we don't need to talk about like the history of the record in this episode because that would make it all so much worse. However, like there is stuff where, like, you know, Max, the singer, talks about the song being very different, and then Don, their producer, sort of getting in and like they didn't have a bridge and we did this and yada yada yada. So like imagining another 16-year-old version of this band who gets paired with like Jerry Finn or Rob Cavallo or something.
I still don't think it would be good, though.
Sped up. I don't know. I think it would, and that's the difference. It's like I think what doesn't hold up about the song is like the fucking speed and like just the general kind of vibe of it,
and the lyrics also, and
in front of my computer,
the lyrics and the chord progression also, I think, are the other two problems in my opinion.
I think the lyrics are like kind of like fun in the way that they're just like over the top teen lyrics. Like I think there's a version of this song because I think that the rest of the record
also reminds me of his Collective Soul. I'm not giving up
my opinion that the whole song is good. Ooh,
it seems like a Collective Soul song.
Yeah. Cause it's the word I know.
Yeah, they're better. Like, Collective Soul's better.
Yeah, sure. Of course, Collective Soul's better.
I guess knowing that he was 16 when he wrote it,
the record is good. Like
I didn't know he was 16. That is helping.
Yeah, I think that's extremely relevant information. Like when you think about our experience of critiquing Blink songs for when they're like fucking like 30, you know, critiquing Jesus Christ, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I guess what I'm saying is like, I think the way, so just to bring it back to what we were actually talking about, which is like specifically kind of the Twitter account, is like, if you were in your 40s and this was your legacy, and like, I mean, I'm very different than I was when I was 16. Like, I suspect you are similarly different. Like, even if there are sort of fairly,
I really don't think I am, unfortunately, very much at all. But do you
write different songs, I guess? I mean, yeah, we're both probably not good examples of this because we spent years and years hosting a Blink-182 podcast. But you must write differently now than you did then.
Yeah.
I know I did. All I'm saying is, like, I think what happens is that initial impetus to sort of, like, weaponize everyone's nostalgia for this, like being in high school and now getting drunk and listening to the song and a blue check mark. And again, a name that basically everyone knows, and like fire off these tweets at other famous people asking about what is ostensibly like your one really big hit is like, as a idea, super fucking funny. And I will like stand behind that. The issue is then you're just like a fucking guy and you have what now is suddenly like this platform, and like maybe you don't have a lot of interest to say on it. I don't know that that's like that guy's fault.
Well, it's more the issue is that he's basically tweeting like he's having a manic episode like 24/7 and just like every 2 minutes. He's like the Eric Alper of having hard times level hot takes about like barely under the surface normie underground culture, but he'll just,
I guess, but like you and I have a lot of like, you know, friends who probably tweet too much and they're like probably,
but that's what I was trying, that's what I was wanting to say. That's what I was going to say is like, you know, there are people that I, especially now in the pandemic, there are people that I mostly only know from being online and it's going to sound ironic coming from me, but I don't really, I mean, if someone's entire perception of me was formed just based on my Twitter account, that would be kind of amazing. I would love that. They would think that I was some sort of guru or something. but there's people that you and I know. I wonder if, I'm going to type the name to you as I say it, but this person, I don't really even know what they're like in real life, to be honest. And I only think of them as their Twitter account. And I mean, that's the thing is, like, at this point in time, your social media is so tied to the reality of who you are as a person that it still does reflect on you as as who you are as a person.
Yeah, that's true. But I think, like, I guess if it still reflects on you, it's still only like it's a specific window. Like, I don't know. Is the argument that you think you should be able to judge like a person based entirely on their Twitter account?
Well, I guess what I'm saying is, like, I feel like the Eve6 guy is just so constantly trying to like get retweeted by Dasha or something. You know, he just like wants so badly to be in a group DM it's just like, oh, it just makes me feel so uncomfortable. I could never give. And then when I was just looking at this, I was like, oh, maybe we'll watch some TV things. I noticed like 9 months ago, he was doing prank videos on YouTube. I didn't watch this yet, but I think he just like wants to be internet famous so bad. And it's working finally. Yeah. He found his thing.
This is great.
I've been doing this for a minute. I know you probably can't tell because I use all kinds of high-powered moisturizers that are contrived from, like, walruses and other endangered species to keep my Irish complexion smooth and moist. But I was in a band called Eve6, and we were opening up for a band called Third Eye Blind. This was at the end of the...
It was presented like it was going to be a tour prank, prank. I thought he was trying to become like a YouTube prankster, which would have been amazing. But I think
I was hoping that this was. Yeah, see, I was really hoping that this was how the intro to his prank video went. Yeah. And I was like, oh, wow. OK. But no, it actually is just like a sort of.
It's just him on tour. OK, so that's good. But I did notice, like, if you look right before this kind of, I guess that's the other sad thing, is just like knowing that it worked for him to become an epic dunk guy on Twitter. Like, it worked. Everyone's been writing about them like crazy. But right before that, like, all their videos are them playing in like Ohio or Edmonton, like just real depressing ass places. So
the entire state of Ohio or Edmonton. it's definitely depressing places for sure. I guess, like, to bring it back to the Twitter thing, I was playing in the middle. I was just going to say, I was like, well, look, I mean, the thing that you like about Nate is that, like, Nate and you and Drew, and then a lot of people who like listen to this show, like, share a sensibility, right? And you just like literally don't share a sensibility with this guy. But does that make him like worse or bad?
I don't think so. I think these are all very superficial things, but in terms of the fact that what he does makes like 75% of people think that I would like it and constantly want to talk to me about it is what makes it so unbearable and frustrating. But even how I feel about the song is like, it's almost something I would like, but it just makes me recoil a little bit.
I'm really mad because I did say last week that it was my goal to get you to like this song. And then I, like, right after listening to it before the show, realized that that was not going to be what was going to happen. Maybe I can make you like his Twitter account, though.
I mean, I'm sure he's like, I'm sure he's been through a lot and has an interesting story. And, like, you know, if he's
I like the idea of, like, this is you hedging, thinking that there's a chance that he's listening.
Well, no, I'm serious though. Like, I'm sure someone who's been through some shit, and if he's like, you know, if sobriety is part of it or whatever, I can understand the compulsion to tweet more if that's happening too. And I'm sure he's like an interesting guy, but his Twitter literally does feel like it's no different than like a brand like Wendy's or whatever, like all these fucking things from 10 years ago is now just a way to promote like a reissue or whatever. Or I think they announced a new album in the middle of all this. So I don't know. It just, it makes me so uncomfortable.
You know what I get? Because first of all, when I finally unfollowed it after like finding it really annoying for like several weeks, I thought to myself, Josiah is winning. And I was so mad about
it. Wait, you cut out while you said that. I want to get a clear take of that.
What I whispered to myself was, Josiah is winning. And I was distraught. I was bereft. It was really tough. You know what this reminds me of a little bit? Because it was definitely very fun to accuse you of being jealous. And it did feel a little bit like, in general, he was like jumping into the backyard of, like, to be totally honest, like a thing that, like, a really like genuinely clever little sort of like bit that you and Drew and Nate had been building that was sort of like funny because, like, you guys are funny and Nate is funny, and it was like the guy from Fun interacting with you two in this like very like level comedic way. And so it was like entertaining for people because there was this wild card element of like a famous person from a band that everyone knows at least one song from. Like, that's fucking cool, right? And so the idea of a guy who is famous for one song at least, you know, coming in and sort of making jokes about an era and that band and stuff sort of felt like it was playing in very similar territory.
But I want to be clear too. It's not just that. It's like, it's literally like the hot takes about music that get my back against the wall.
I totally get it.
And when I used to say like, I don't like ranking songs, like, this is why, like, I hate being like fucking, this Lonesome Crowded West is dog shit compared to This Is a Long Drive. That's like, to me, that's like the same as hot dog is a sandwich discourse. Like, it's just like, yeah. I actually think that music can't really be given like sports like ranking, like fantasy football ass rankings. I think it's more complicated than that and more interesting. And and that's actually what I have found profoundly interesting and moving about genuinely digging into Imagine Dragons or Hinder or things like that, is like not just being like, here's a fucking Neil deGrasse Tyson gif for your ass. Imagine Dragons actually fucking rocks, but instead being like, I'm actually going to listen to it and try to bring my own personal history and try to engage with it as a piece of art, because that's what it is, whether or not it's good. Like, that's the other thing I think about these kind of people is like, it's too much of like a epic dunk attitude, whereas I've been sort of doing a slower epic dunk by actually treating these so-called bad low culture things with the same level of respect that I would something that is beloved.
Yeah, you've been doing a slower, epicer dunk.
Exactly.
It's interesting to see like his trajectory versus like, and there's a, you know, a slight generational difference, right? But like the Mark McGrath sort of online experience, which is rooted in many of the same like remember kind of like notions, but comes across so much more sincere, like even the fake cameo breakup video. But like, you know, I think about listening to his, like when he was on Yeah But Still, like, you know, he's a dude who's like into talking shit. He'll give you that sort of like 90s gossip kind of nonsense that you're craving, but it's coming from someone who actually feels like they are very much still themselves. Like, you very much like the Mark McGrath thing is like, he feels like a sort of bro rock guy from the 90s. And the weird thing about this is that you're like, are you just like a Red Scare? It's like a Red Scare fan. Like,
yeah. And, you know, and also like, there's, for his whole bit to be like, do you like my song? That like, I still think most people think this song sucks. I still think like in the grand scheme of things,
that's outrageous.
I still think that he, by him doing this bit, he's openly admitting that it sucks. And then you're telling me he's actually like a sick songwriter who's written good songs. So that to me is also a red flag of like, is this guy just really insecure and hiding something? And he's kind of overcompensating for the fact that he does think he didn't get enough credit for his talent. And so that's why he's constantly like, do you like my epic viral song? Hey, NASA, have you ever heard my epic viral bad song that sucks a lot? You know, it's like, have some,
you should be asking him about Promise might be a more advanced song.
Maybe I want to just help him. Maybe I do want to become friends with him and just help him out.
Social media manager, you know, but I actually think this is important. And this is like, this feels like an old pod sort of transgression, but it's more that I want to be honest with you to try to repair some of the damage that me calling you jealous of the U6 guy that may have caused our relationship. Which is that when, like Brendan Kelly from the Lawrence Arms, I feel like similarly like blew up in an exclusively like org Corey way for being like a very epic shit poster. And also running the Nihilist Arby's account. I was like, this sucks. And it made me, I like love the Lawrence Arms. It made me like kind of like be like, this guy's like whole personality fucking rubs me the wrong way. And like, I was not jealous of the guy from the Lawrence Arms being like a kind of shit poster guy, but there was just a similar thing where it like blew up, and it blew up like a little bit also outside of just like pure kind of core circles. And I was like, it's like gross. And I think it would have been fair to call me jealous, maybe because I was, maybe I'm projecting here, but I get it.
I think the other people that you don't like, that I'm not going to name names, but the other people that you're not a huge fan of, I think you're jealous of them. But
okay, you should put them in the chat and I'll tell you yes or no.
Okay.
And then
here's the first one. I already know the first one is yes.
Yes, but, oh yeah, that's a yes. That's a big yes for that.
This
one
I think I think this one secretly is a yes, but it's you're gonna get mad. So,
Patreon.com/boomer55. No. Yes.
Yeah, you are.
But what about you?
No.
What about you?
No, come I have on. No interest. No. I have no interest in, God, in being like true, this actually, person. You don't. I have absolutely no interest in it. I basically that's would love me. To just keep doing exactly what I'm doing right now. And yeah, that's it. Me. I mean, I'm fine. I'm not trying to.
Can you do me a favor though? Just because I've admitted to being jealous of two people on Twitter, which is like obscene.
Wait,
can
you just you're jealous of their person? Twitters or of.
No. But they're Twitter. They're also Twitter. I'm not jealous of them on Twitter. So just can you just tell me one person you're jealous of? I want to see that. I want to see the.
This is like fucking. This is so. This is like therapy right now.
This is.
I'll have to think. Yeah, I'll have to think of a real one.
Okay, so I expect by
on Thursday we'll think about it if we want to talk about this or not. But in Discord we might. Okay, what if the guy from Eve 6 joins the Discord? That would be weird.
You know what? Then we'll have to engage them on our turf though, which is good. So yeah, actually, if you want to, you know, are we about to get into covers? Like, I mean, I'm done talking.
Yeah,
about
I don't know. I mean, did we say anything at all? I feel like I've just been sort of.
What do people want to know? Like, it's it rocks. You know, it's maybe better in your memory than it is to just revisit. But if it's late and you don't have any cocaine and you want to get a party going anyway, you could still put it on. It'll still absolutely turn it.
I don't think that's. I think that we've. Literally sped up the nostalgia cycle so much that there's almost nothing like this left that you could do that with. It would have to be a song from like 6 months ago, or it'd have to be Pow Fu. You'd be like, yo, remember Pow Fu?
I do find that like there's a few songs that I think about slightly less often that like when they come to you, it is like a bolt of lightning that illuminates the room and you're like, oh, we should listen to like Jerk by Kim Stockwood or whatever, and like, you know, it's at least a little bit of a change,
right? But it's still it's getting more and more. You're needing a more and more hardcore nostalgia to pump through your veins to get you to get.
But that is real running. Though, right? Because like, I think I remember. Although I recently realized that, like, I don't think I ever put on any Savage Garden, and that could really like.
Before we get to real covers, this is kind of an old pod thing. This is before the Twitter comeback. This is the kind of person covering it. This guy wearing a backwards Kangol, and he's playing an Epiphone with the capo on the F on fret 1, so he doesn't have to do as many bar chords, and his guitar's completely out of tune.
He's really like. This video also kind of has like I don't know if you use Zoom for work? Like are you a Zoom?
We use company? Google Hangouts.
Okay, so Zoom has a feature that it I think is like by default turned on. If it's not, I mean it's like the first thing anyone does, which is like it smooths out your webcam a little bit and it makes you look like 5 years younger.
Oh but yeah. I know what you're talking about.
Cause some like motion blurring, like if you move your hands too quick, which for a while this video looked like it had the like Zoom pretty face blur on it.
I mean, this guy it's also if this was the Eve 6 internet resurrection, I would be all aboard. It's like just like a dude with all of his furniture came from his grandma when she died, and he has a Line 6 on top of a red practice amp. And you can't tell if he's wearing sweats or jeans. I mean, that's the best energy.
Yeah, that should be it.
Respect to that guy. I mean, definitely respect to that guy. His name is John Three.
Respect to a Kangol King.
And the best part is my YouTube is currently logged in as Exclaim. So I'm probably going to fuck.
Nice.
I need to make sure I change it before we record Globe Hell this week. Otherwise, it'll be all like binaural beats to relieve diarrhea or whatever. All right, let's listen to the covers. I mean,
wow, a little bit of a preview, eh, for the fans.
It was a very loaded cover call this week because we made it very clear that I was not happy about this and that you were.
Yeah.
So I'm curious what people will have done. It was funny.
I kind of want to know. Yeah, like did people cover it from a place of love, like I would have? Were they covering it from a place of like, you know, irony? Were they covering it from a place of resentment, like you? Like where, you know? And I suspect we will not be able to tell.
So, and just remember, if you're listening for the first time, if you're the Eve Six guy, and you're listening for the first time, if you want to cover the songs we're doing on the show, you can sign up for Patreon, patreon.com/155pod, and we tell you the song a week in advance, and then we usually release a wonderful Bandcamp compilation every Monday. We'll see what this one's like. I'm sure maybe we can get some of that sweet, sweet blogger action from doing this compilation. But I mean,
that's the other thing, right? I don't think it's worse than you probably ever thought the tweets were. If it was literally just like 10,000 people following an account and a couple people you know retweeted it, I actually don't think it would have bothered you. But it was like the narrative, like the aggressiveness of the narrative, right? Because it wasn't just people tweeting like, OMG, good sir, you've won Twitter. It was like articles with that headline. Right.
Yeah, I think that's definitely part of it. I don't know. I think I'm just done with
it. That seemed like out of whack with how funny it was.
I think I need to get on one of those free speech social media platforms now. I think I'm just done with Twitter. All right, let's
go to get a Gab account just to talk freely about Eve Six. Okay.
First up, we got Trevor Impersonator. The song is called Clips and Phrases, which is very kind of highbrow seeming to me.
This is like if you were ending your Eve Six podcast and you were trying to come up with like a really meaningful title for your big final compilation.
I would swallow my pride, I would choke on the ride, but the lack thereof would lit me up the inside. I would swallow my pride, I would choke on the ride, but the lack thereof.
Who does his voice sound like?
Oh wow. Well, I don't know. This is great, though.
Yeah, this is really good. For fuck's sake. He kind of sounds like Elvis Costello. Like someone doing a bad Elvis Costello impression. God damn it, Trevor Impersonator. This is wonderful.
Yeah, that was good as hell.
I liked it. And that just
sounds to me like I'm doing an Eve Six impression now, but it definitely sounds like also I'm doing another impression.
It almost has the same voice as some like early 2000s kind of like yelpy indie rock kind of stuff too.
It sounds like Interpol.
The songs are boring. Yeah. And stuff.
I was listening to the band
Interpol. I
was listening to the band Lady Hawk the other day for the first time in many years. It doesn't really hold up, but at the time, I mean, it's still pretty good. The songs are really like the guitar, especially the instruments are so sick. But something about the vocals, it sounded neutral at the time. But going back and listening now, I was like, there was a 2000s kind of sound where people were doing that. There's like some sort of yelp to it that I didn't notice as much at the time.
A lot of rock vibrato.
Yeah. And just kind of like, it's neither singing from the chest or the stomach or the throat. It's kind of like, if there's such a thing as a taint between the nose and the mouth, that's kind of where you're singing from.
You do sort of have a little taint in there. The angel's taint, the angel's kiss. Where the angels give you life through your tank.
Up next is Foley, who has submitted twice, but one of them features guest vocals. Let's do the guest vocals on the pod, and then we can hear the other one when the compilation comes out on Monday. Bandcamp Mondays. Fuck Bandcamp Friday. We don't ask for any money at all. We're way better than those greedy artists. This says Sin Side Out is what it's called. The guest vocals are from Scott Wazalewski.
Choke on the rhyme, lack thereof, lead me up to your side. Swallow my doubt, turn my side out. Faith in nothing. Put my tender heart in a blender. Watch us spin around to a beautiful oblivion. Rendezvous through a
oh, what is happening right now?
The Sin Side is out. Sin is loose. This is like, I feel like Foley or Scott Wolowski have hidden from the tree of knowledge.
It's true.
Well, okay. That was spooky. I liked it.
The tree of knowledge, and you were talking about the angel's taint, and then I was thinking about the Adam's apple, and all of it brought me back to Eve 6. So it is kind of all happening right now in terms of free word association. So that's kind of something, I guess. That, you know, it reminding me of the Newsboys has helped me come to terms with this song a little bit, I'll be honest, but...
It hasn't helped me because now I'm coming to terms with maybe liking the Newsboys. Like, well, I don't know.
Anything that gets you closer to becoming born again is good enough for me.
It's a victory, right?
So, yeah. So what's the deal with this next person's name?
Okay, so the next track is from Sean Mendes' His Lawyer's Best Friend. Now, I don't know if – I don't think I've talked about this on the pod before. Uh-huh. So – at this point, I mean, I was going to say like a couple months ago, but a couple of years ago before the pandemic, I was at a Shawn Mendes concert and, you know, had this like very kind of surprise. Why? Okay. I was trying to cut myself off by playing.
Oh, I see.
Pause. On
I was like, I want to hear the story.
I was trying to do a thing. Anyway, this is Shawn Mendes' His Lawyer's Best Friend.
That's clever.
Inside Out Shawn's Partner Edition.
Are these the same lyrics?
I don't think so.
Train.
Worldwide.
There's artwork. Will this help with the clue? What? The cover art for this song, which will be on our Instagram on Monday, is that me photoshopped onto
Camila? Right. Okay, so this is I believe a Camila Cabello cover. So Camila Cabello also has a song called Inside Out.
Now, do you know Camila Cabello's lawyer, or no? Do they have the same lawyer?
I don't know that. I have to admit, you know, when I've been bested, and no, I do not know Camila Cabello's lawyer.
Fuck. Okay.
You know, I could use IMDb Pro, though, and you want to find out?
Do you have IMDb Pro?
Yeah, bro.
Oh, shit.
Yeah, pro. next time you need somebody's fucking email, you just let me know.
No kidding. Damn.
Patreon.com/Blink-155pod. Once a month, I will give you.
I mean, that's never been the URL, but.
What did I say it was? Listen, I was too busy trying to look up. Of course, everyone knows Daniel Passman and Gene Solomon from Gang Tire, Ramner, Brown, and Passman, you know.
And so you're not friends with them. Something to aspire to, I guess.
I don't know Gene or Dan.
Okay, up next, I'm really excited about this one, actually. This is Todd Killings, the legend, formerly known as Gob Killings. And we're going to let this one play a little bit longer. This was an attempt at a polka for Sammy, but polka without accordion is just ska.
Oh, that's true.
I always appreciated Weird Al's genius, but actually trying to make a parody gives me a new respect. I drunkenly freestyled all the words over a few takes. So I guess Al and I have a slightly different process. And then Shannon from Vampire Crack also found some samples. So this is called Mince Pie Out.
Potatoes gone to starch now. It's a mushy, watery mess. I don't want to look at the cabbage.
This is my favorite thing I've ever heard.
It's the best music that I've ever heard.
The queen's about to burst. Would you like your appetizer burst? I can eat shepherd's pie. I would choke on the rind, but the lactose.
Wow.
Okay. All right. Wow. I'm glad we did this episode now.
This is good. I also just want to say those lyrics being drunkenly freestyled, to me, like, so rarely are the things that anyone does drunk, like, as good as you think that they are. But that sounds like how every time you do something drunk, you hope it's going to sound, you know? Where you're like, I want all of the chaos of this moment to be accurately captured, and then it's just like embarrassing.
I agree.
That was beautiful.
There was also some like grimy fucking, I mean, everything about that was so grimy, and it sounded like, it kind of sounded like, to be honest, another artist I've never really listened to. And now that he's kind of canceled beyond repair, that's fine. I don't need to. But I think if you're sad about the cancellation and are looking for someone with kind of a similar like 80s New York grimy graffitied wall, haunted graffiti, so to speak. To me, that sounded like what I imagine Ariel Pink sounds like in an ideal, like a glass half full version of Ariel Pink.
Wow. I always assumed Ariel Pink was like just too boring to even be that.
No, Ariel Pink's
that's
like
just,
annoying
that's just how
troll
not
music.
Right wing I am.
Yeah, no, no, it's not. I don't think Ariel Pink is certainly not boring. But anyways, that was amazing. Todd Killings is my favorite, one of my favorite artists in the world. So I mean, hell yeah. Up next, yes. I think the title of this one is perhaps an insult towards us. Inside Oot.
Oh, okay, but the comment is very exciting.
It is exciting. But before we talk about that, I am curious. I think that if anything, Canadians would say the word, the OUT word, overly enunciated and say out. Whereas Americans probably say like oat or.
Yeah.
Now I don't know, actually.
Anytime you start talking, it's, you know, Schrodinger's accent, you know?
Yeah, this is Normalcy, and this does say Durst vibes because last week Normalcy submitted a cover of Soda that was intended to be hardcore, and we both thought it sounded like Durst. And she was I don't hear it at all. And then someone, another, like an independent third party who hasn't heard the pod also heard Durst vibes. So let's hear what happens.
Well, yeah, it's like, what's going on with this background is... I feel like I had to on Discord be like, when I say Durst vibes, it's kind.
Yeah, exactly.
Cool. Okay.
Okay, Fred Durst. Oh, I'm gonna let this play for a sec. I gotta say, okay. I don't think I'm gonna end this liking the song, but I will, as usual, end it loving the nation and the people who submit covers. Right. I mean, that's just, that's a given.
I just want to say, like, Normalcy has fully nailed the energy of the first Limp Bizkit album with that. Like, that's what I'm hearing there. Like, I'm hearing, like, you know, like Stuck. You know, yeah. I'm not hearing Nookie there. Like, that is full
$3 bill, y'all.
$3 bill.
There's someone who really has gracefully become self-awarely funny, but also aloof enough that they still seem human and they still seem like the same guy as before. Because it just doesn't – nothing Fred Durst does seems calculated, but he's even, like, funny on TikTok now. Like, Fred Durst has just kind of –
Oh, I haven't seen that.
Yeah, yeah. He's just – there's a difference, right? You could be a true head who's just, like, on the internet in a nice – way that no one could be mad at. Up next is Eve Flag. Or you want to talk about Durst?
I do just want to say that I think, like, one of the interesting things about living in an era of social media is, like, the way that it kind of lets you see, like, oh, we were right about Fred Durst. Like, you know what I mean? Like, I think that's kind of the way that I take all that is, like, we were right about Fred Durst. On some level, maybe we were all right about Mark McGrath. Like, he's whatever. And at the same time, I can relate, like, if we look back on, like, my own fucking tweets, I can relate to someone who, like, thinks too much about them and is trying to be a certain type of person. So I just want to bring it back to a place of empathy here.
It's true.
But also loving Fred Durst.
But Fred Durst rules. Okay, this is called Eve Flag, so maybe it's going to be some...
Yeah. I recently watched a video of... Rollins and Cyndi Lauper. Like this.
What Black Flag vocalist does this sound like? It sounds like...
I mean, it actually does kind of sound like Henry talking.
Yeah, it kind of does. Actually, it's pretty sick.
That's like really good.
It's pretty faithful.
There's like a big, I feel like I haven't been on the Discord much, but I feel like there's like a fairly significant like Black Flag debate happening right now. But I would say that's probably the best era of Black Flag is E Flag.
Yeah, I think you're right. I also love with the way that we look at these covers, not having any idea where these came from. Like it's making me even have the less context right. I have is helping more, which is funny because we didn't talk about this on the pod yet, but last week Hallie was our friend Daniel Halliburton and we had no idea.
Yeah. No idea. We like talked about the name and then the next day, how did you put it together? Did he tell you?
Yeah, because I had this panic attack that something didn't work with the upload. Because actually, it didn't work to upload to the site, so it was only in the Gmail. And so on the compilation on Bandcamp, there is a Jake Rolfe cover that didn't get played on the episode. So I had a panic attack that because Daniel had told me he was submitting, and I panicked that we didn't play it. And then but anyways, yeah, everyone go check out Jake Rolfe on Bandcamp and shoot some woofs his way. Up next is Soothing Kitchen Sounds with Inside Mouth. Let's go. This is good. This is really good. This just sounds like the books. Start playing some acoustic guitar on top. Really nice in the 3D audio too.
Oh yeah. This is a great reason to check it out on Bandcamp. You want this full immersive sonic experience.
Mm-hmm. The blender is a little too literal for me, maybe. It made me remember the lyrics of what we're listening to, but still.
Right. You've been sort of sucked back to reality.
Yeah, it's just a little on the nose, but otherwise I loved it. It was a very immersive listening experience, so thank you, Soothing Kitchen Sounds, for that. Up next is Sparkling Water. Got to shout out Caleb, who is officially an employee of the 155 LLC. So Sparkling Caleb is now helping out with in terms of getting all these ridiculously poorly labeled songs put into one folder and mastered and put on Bandcamp every week. So, and as I was like, oh, it's no big deal. I'll keep doing it. As I was laying it all out for Caleb, I was like, I can't believe I've been doing this every week because I'm so bad at this kind of stuff also.
Yeah, Caleb, you can't see it, but I'm doing a thing where I like put my hands together and bow, and then I wonder if like, is this okay that I, but I'm doing it. So thank you, Caleb.
Like you thought it was an appropriation thing or something?
Yeah, like just like, I don't know, it's like, is this not cool?
So sparkling, sparkling water.
Is it not cool? I was worried that it's not cool.
And I mean, now I think it's just kind of, yeah, now all the things I want to riff on it, I'm like, are those things going to be cool to say? So Sparkling Water with the cover is social media is the gamification of narcissism. And then in parentheses, what if the song had a guitar solo? Yeah. Oh my god. That is a stanky guitar.
The guitar at the beginning of Back to the Future. Like I feel like I just got blown over.
Yeah, I feel like the Maxell cassette guy right now.
Yeah.
Okay, legit though, wow. That is some sick playing.
No, that was awesome. It being it also like in that context, great. Really great.
And I see you.
That's an excellent way to use what is obviously a tremendous amount of talent.
And Caleb, I see you've submitted a WAV file and it's labeled correctly, so that's less work for you. Sucker. Okay, up next, this is called Everclear featuring Eve 6, produced by Everlast. Fucking 155 listeners make it so fun no matter what. Yes! There's another 2 minutes of that. Respect to whoever put that together. Also, the song, it's Everclear featuring Eve 6 produced by Everlast, but the song itself is called Pain. That's sick. Much respect for that. How did you feel about that one, Sam? Did it go down smooth?
I didn't hear a bunch of it because I had sort of scrolled away. And when it started, it took me too long to find how to turn it down. And I was worried that I was going to experience like a permanent issue, so I had to kind of take my headphones out. What I heard, excellent.
I would like to get more into harsh noise to the point where I could like bullshit about it. I mean, I used to have some Sightings records and a few other Load Records things, and I've never like. I remember Mertzbau played in Calgary, and I didn't go, and I wish I did because that would have been such a sick thing to say, but. There's no way that.
Yeah, I remember when Mertzbau played the Cathedral like years and years ago. I think I was probably still in high school, but I like knew that I should go and I couldn't. And I kind of wish I had at that age because I feel like if I had an experience like that, I would be like, oh, I love and appreciate Mertzbau. And you'd always have a story about seeing Mertzbau live. And now it's like pure post shit for me.
Yeah, but I think that's what I'm trying to say is I kind of think it is for everyone. And that's what I like about it is like right. The kind of things where you literally couldn't possibly not be posing. And that's why it's tight, kind
of. Right. Like it is a bit of a like Emperor's like new clothes kind of thing. Yeah,
just, like, although having said that, get, the depth of that blown out sound did have like something. There was something in there that was like, it wasn't just like static. There was like, it was kind of evolving in those 40 seconds, even for me.
It sounds like you're getting ready.
I'm ready.
I'm excited for this phase.
It's time to get more pretentious. Okay. Teen Jazz, back at it again. This is BB155 Bar Blender 6.8 review, all in one. And Teen Jazz, a.k.a. James, has said, I picked up from your tone of voice last week, this one's going to be a rough one. So if you're looking for a bit of a palate cleanser, here you go. So there's pod magic going on. I think we should just hit play. I mean, I don't know if we want to play these YouTube videos that come with it, but...
Well, there's one last section of this area that I think... That I don't know. I don't know how you feel about this section.
I literally sound younger.
I know you think it's important.
We both do.
Introducing an upgrade to our two-speed basic bar blenders. The heavy-duty base of the BB155 series blender is durable and easy to clean.
I have had this blender for 3 years and it is wonderful. Very easy to clean and works well for protein shakes with ice. The only part to wear out was the coupling, but it was easily replaced for $6 since this is a commercial product. Would definitely buy again. This is a very simple wearing black blender. I once had a wearing red blender made of glass and metal. Now's is more updated to a plastic, but still very nice and easy to use and clean.
A 2-year motor warranty guarantees reliable performance you can count on. More powerful 3/4 horsepower commercial motors make these blenders the workhorses of any bar business.
I was tired of trying to get my kitchen blender to make smooth blended drinks. This one not only makes a smooth drink, it makes it fast, perfect daiquiris, margaritas, and lava flows right at home. Sort of noisy, but it doesn't take long to finish. Great product for its price, I use it in my business. It lasts long and works forever. This is an excellent blender, easy to use and easy to clean.
They can handle whatever your customers order, powering through tough jobs like crushing ice with no problem.
It does exactly what it's supposed to, make frozen drinks perfectly. It's not for smoothies or soup. Forget the trendy juice blenders. This commercial grade can whip up anything you want to create. I make juices daily and it blends everything I put into it without chance. This is a great bar blender if you like frozen drinks. It is capable of crushing ice to make great margaritas. I have had one for years and so have my two sons. I love this blender. This is my third one of these and would never buy a different brand. Have used this for a few months to make morning smoothies. Works great overall and comes apart for easy cleanup in the dishwasher.
Waring has upgraded the containers on this line too, with a 44-ounce BPA-free copolyester jar on the BB155 and a 32-ounce stainless steel container on the BB155S.
Works just like the 40-plus-year-old one that finally gave up the ghost last year. I'm very pleased.
I have no idea what's happening anymore.
Do you want to hear covers?
No! Incredible.
Respect. Oh my God.
Like, yeah.
I'm moved by that. I mean, that was just beautiful. Do you not think that our voices sounded genuinely younger at the start of that?
Like hundreds of years younger.
We sounded like little babies.
Yeah. Like who would ever listen to a baby podcast, which is obviously what the previous one was.
I also like that. You know, that was kind of a generic sentence from me, but I know that it was definitely sampled from the infamous TV repair section. But it, like, could have been from anywhere. Like, it almost served no purpose, but it was just kind of a tip of the hat. So respect to all the old school fans. And if you're listening to this and you didn't listen to all of Blink-155, I mean, that's cool, but also you're not as cool as the others.
No. Yeah. There's a ranking.
Okay, up next is... The Blended Hearts featuring Roxy the Hyena and Zupa Nelpy 4. Inside Out, Sammy's mix. I love the niche, but picking this song was too silly. I think I got everything you guys asked for in here. So last week we were talking some shit. I don't even know.
I said I wanted to, yeah, it was like polka with a trap beat. It was like trap polka.
I'm not hearing the polka, but This just sounds like the Dirty Projectors to me. Oh, there's some polka. There's some polka.
Yeah.
This is actually sick as hell. Oh, and the hyena sounds. Oh, I forgot. God. We asked for the hyena sounds.
Hyenas.
I think we're on to something. Wow. Really.
No, that was good. That was really good.
That was amazing.
Wow.
That must have been Roxy the hyena letting out those yelps. So sick.
Yeah. Great work, Roxy.
Okay. Clown Calls Dropout. Let's do this. Is this also going to be a polka trap song?
I would swallow my pride. I would choke on lies. But the last one would
lie. Yeah, true.
Swallow my doubt. Turn it inside out. Find nothing but faith in nothing. Want to put my tender.
This is exactly what it feels like. This is what it feels is going to feel like when I'm typing this song title into the metadata, putting it on this.
It's a good song.
This one.
That one. I just mean the classic circus jam.
Is that just called really like the circus march or something? That's
the feel of the circus, you know?
It's true. I was thinking of that meme where someone is sort of putting on more and more clown makeup as they share different statements or whatever. Like, you know, I can't think of an example. It's kind of like a reverse galaxy brain where you're dressing up as a clown as you say things. And I was thinking of kind of myself earlier whining about somebody using Twitter in a way that I find annoying, and how that was me putting on the clown makeup gradually. As I was saying,
right. So,
just an all-around bad vibes tonight. But thank you for that Clown College Dropout. You've reflected it.
Okay,
correctly.
So that song is actually called "Entrance of the Gladiators," and it is by a Czech composer named Julius Fuck.
No,
it's not really. It's like Julius Fuckick. But it, like the eye is very small. I look at. I suspect I'm not.
Oh,
the first.
Oh wow, it's, he's
basically
cool.
This Julius is named Fuck. Like
yeah,
for
his
sure.
name is definitely Julius Fuck, and he looks cool as hell. Damn! Shout out to Julius Fuck.
Sometimes he's known as the Bohemian Sousa.
He was the uncle of the journalist Julius Fuck, also similar name, who was executed by the Third Reich. So that's not very funny.
Damn. Tough time.
You'd make me read that on here. It's sad.
I just want to listen. You know, we've had some jokes about things that we don't like, but I just want to say the one thing that we both genuinely don't like is the Third Reich.
I'm next.
The first two?
I'll see you later. I'll see you later. A couple of people have shouted out the user Unentitled. I don't know who they are, but they're always delivering the stems every week. So if you go into the Discord, you can get the stems for whatever song we're doing. So here's I'll see you later. This is kind of some Czech composition shit, but if it was played by a modem.
Some Julius Fuck action, yeah.
Yeah.
Julius Digifuck.
So wait, there are some stems from the
cabinet. Shock white. Oh, so frail.
Oh, and then it gets to the... If we hadn't have let it keep playing, we wouldn't have known that it also quickly became a sort of spoken word thing. So that,
yeah.
But I'm trying to figure out where the
stems come
are.
From. Yeah,
was it, I'll see you no, later on the original track doing that kind of spoken word? Or
I think so. That was a sick vibe. I'm like unsettled.
All right, Quiche Baby, Inside Out, Final. Hey, sorry to submit twice. I realized there was a long silence. Guess what? Not my problem. Take it up with Sparkling Caleb.
Oh, yeah. A great synth sound and a lot of room.
Yeah, stabs are always good.
Oh, yeah.
This seems like it could be like a very, very early 2000s Philip Glass composition that people have just tried to forget. I'm just assuming that he has some like awful Columbia House CD days compositions, Philip Glass, that are kind of like the forgotten shitty years.
Just maybe like washed he, Philip Glass
when he
era.
First got, yeah, his flop era when he first got a computer. They're like, God damn it.
He was just like, ooh, okay. I'm gonna take a these stabs are pretty sick.
Philip Glass just got his first Line 6 pedal. I'm going to town on this shit. Okay, up next, the Golden Umbrella Stance, Inside Out. This is, again, the dude that covers songs when he has never heard the artist or the song. So I'm excited about that. Because of this one.
Also, recently he adopted a puppy who loves sounds. You can't hum around this puppy without it jumping on you. And so he has to record these in the car before the puppy wakes up.
That is a really cute puppy.
Oh, there's a photo.
Yeah, but make sure you open it in a new window or you're going to fuck up our whole vibe.
I don't. Oh, look at this puppy. I would record in my car for that puppy. That was sick.
I mean, obviously that sounded nothing like the song, but what does it sound like? I don't know. It almost does sound like some of the 2000s. Yelp era bands of like with the synths and stuff and kind of the danciness of it. It's cool though. Good.
I think there's also like a specific energy, like, you know, when you have a certain idea for something, but you know, everyone here is forced to record these songs in such like unique circumstances. Like just the timeline is small. You know, who knows what you have available to you because it's a pandemic. Like even if you have a practice space and gear, maybe you can't, like, you know.
Yeah.
And so as a result, like whatever your idea is also then gets filtered through you having to record it in your car before your puppy wakes up. And so it's never 100% the thing that anyone intends. And like that is the reason also why I think so many of the covers are so
magical,
fundamentally interesting. Yeah.
It's true. It's so true. I'm so jealous of the people that...
There's not enough time to do what you think you're doing.
I am so... You know? You asked me who I was jealous of. I'm so jealous of the people who get to just be a listener of our show and get to make this stuff all the time. Wouldn't that be fun?
There's in the first Shawn Mendes single from the new album, Wonder,
Is this Spawn?
This is Spawn right now. Sorry, I should say before what I say next is Spawn. But there's like a lyric where I think it's like, I wonder what it's like to be my friends. You know, there's a lot of wondering in the song. And like I sort of had, it was like in the background for the first time. And I was like, did he just say, I wonder what it's like to be my fans? Like I thought that was the lyric, which is just like a little nuttier.
I feel like it's worse to say, I wonder what it's like to be my friends because you're more intimately aware of them.
Like, right. Maybe that's not what the lyric is.
Maybe saying, I wonder what it's like to be my fan is more like that's what they probably talk about in board meetings. But to be like, man,
I
wonder how sick it is to be my friend. Those people are so fucking lucky. And that, and I do think,
do you wonder what it's like to be your friend?
I do think that they're lucky. They're all very lucky.
Yeah.
No, but I imagine, because even when we cover things, when we make music for this project, there's like extra baggage because it's our thing. So it has to be good. But if you could just like,
yeah, that's true.
I don't know, man, that'd be so fun. I wish that I could just be my own fan.
You just say, I wonder what it's like to be my friends. Hope they don't think I'll forget about them. Ooh.
Whoa. Yeah, that's pretty arrogant, Shawn Mendes.
Cutting to the quick there.
If Shawn Mendes' lawyer is listening to this, just try to get some humility over to that guy, you know? Okay, Tender Hell, one of my absolute favorites, Tender Hell. Let's hear this.
Yes.
Whoa. If you put all of these Tender Hell covers beside each other, it would probably be one of the most diverse collections that have been on here. Like, she is just changing the game every week.
The gating on the vocal is so sick.
Oh, beautiful. Oh,
yeah.
I loved it. Amazing Tender Hell. Thank you. It's tender heaven to me. It's rough heaven is what I think it is. Gosh Dang is here. This is a really funny idea, actually. My idea for this was to compose the entire song literally inside out by starting with the middle of the song first and working backwards to the beginning, then going back to the end of the song and working my way back to the middle. I reversed all the chord progressions and reversed the lines of the lyrics. It didn't actually end up sounding very good. Gosh dang, let's hear this. Inside out, but the lack thereof would leave me empty inside. I would swell in my pride, I would choke on the ground. Demented eyes and moves in your head, folded up in just its end. Or am I overcoming? I'm not as ugly size as me, but it's not my state of mind. So I count as where my mind stays. I'm David Van Fool with you. Watch it spin around to a beautiful oblivion. While I put my tender heart in a blender, find nothing but faith in nothing. I would swallow my doubt, turn it inside out, but the lack thereof would leave me empty inside. I would swallow my pride, I would choke on the lies.
Okay, I mean, I was doing full like YouTube react face to that whole thing. What an outrageous idea to see through to its completion. I'm just like, I'm in awe of the effort, like truly in awe.
If anyone's like looking for even more of a challenge, I would love to hear a full band take on that composition.
Yeah. Fill that out. Yeah. Fill that out.
Is this Let's what get,
like that could be a full collab, you know?
That was like really if, you
know, who plays drums, who can play bass, who can add accordion to that? Like let's
add the fucking accordion.
Fucking love to hear a full band outside in. Like I would love it.
That was amazing. I was kind of doing YouTuber face too, and I'm gonna follow through on the YouTuber face and just say to you, gosh dang. Kudos to you, my good sir, for that. Because yeah, it was
won the internet.
You did win the internet with that one.
Sure, won the internet.
Up next is Bozio Head with Creep 6. I was already thinking the last one sounded like how they might write like a newer Radiohead song.
That definitely is like when I think about what I imagine Radiohead sounds like now.
Yeah. Man, Radiohead is so
that's good.
I think all Radiohead is good, probably. Maybe I keep saying I need to listen to Radiohead. I remember
actually listening to the last album and being like, this is pretty good.
Yeah.
Do I like all Radiohead, actually?
Okay, DRMC wanted to not do a cover, but then DRMC realized they could fight the system from the inside, so they fought it. It seems like there's some original lyrics here as well. So here's DRMC with Inside Out. Swallow my pride, choke on the ride, still lives me empty inside. Hearing my wow. name sung in a basically the original sea shanty,
right?
Original viral sea shanty.
Hearing your name sung in the context of a Bad Religion parody of an Eve 6 song, is this always where you knew your life was headed? Is that?
Yeah, there are some thrills to this episode I wasn't expecting. So I got to say, shout out to the people who did suggest it. I guess you were right in the sense of bringing me to this dark place has been. Ironically illuminating, I guess, because I just got to hear this is Josiah's greatest nightmare.
I like that the end result of this is not that you've decided that you like the song, but more that you just really liked the episode.
Yeah, exactly. Well, because that was the problem, is too much of us calling everything sick and like talking about chart placement on songs so far. So it's good to have
I do feel like, yeah, talking shit on something was like really nice. I wish I didn't constantly worry that the architect of the song could find the pod,
because like, he is blocked on the pod and on my too many people we follow on with the pod were retweeting it, so I just blocked him fully. So I don't, but he could find you yourself. Or he could find you through Shawn Mendes's lawyer, who you're friends with. Here's Unentitled, who does all the tracks for everyone. So extra shout out to Unentitled, regardless of how good this cover is.
The way you said that sort of made it sound like you expected the cover to be bad.
I didn't, but I was just saying, like, you've already won.
And then the cover is good.
And this is incredible. Ooh, except the real vocals are... Very sick, Matthew emo.
Yeah, like the riff though. Is fucking awesome.
It's weird too how the song is like, it's so verbose, but there's no melody to most of it. It's just like bludgeoning you. There's no like foreplay to this song. It's just bludgeoning you with this monotone. It's just like,
that's one of the things that's interesting, like in this context to realize. And again, I think like in like really trying to think critically about the song is that like. It is like, is that the hook? No, 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 no. Like it's, you know, again, I actually do feel like, and this is not me thinking about someone listening to it, but more the way that I felt sometimes when we were like really going to town on Blink-182 demos is like, it's a 16-year-old song, you know?
Yeah. I mean, that'd be cool if that's how it was treated instead of just tweeting it at Condoleezza Rice or whatever the fuck he's doing now, you know, like.
Okay, but again, that's funny. That was funny.
I don't think he tweeted it at her. My fake example was just too funny.
Your fake example was too good.
Okay, here's Wood Chips.
I would swallow my pride, I would choke on the rinds, but the lack thereof would leave me empty inside. I would swallow my doubt, turn it inside, I'll find nothing but faith in nothing. Wanna put my
this track is in honor of the other 90s artist to use the phrase, put my tender heart in a blender. I don't know what that is, do you?
Like a chump.
No.
Oh, like a chump? Wait, did Fred Durst?
Oh, put my tender heart in a blender and still I surrendered. Hey, yeah.
Oh, shit.
Yeah.
So wait, wow. Was he referencing? When did Nookie
that's
come
also
out?
99?
99 he could have been. Okay, that's another thing I wanted to mention last week. you know, fuck it. Let's just.
I can't believe how much Durst there was this week.
Let's just
keep 99. Yeah.
Let's just keep going off topic and then hey. People can get a taste of what it's like when we babble off topic even more behind the paywall. But last week I forgot to mention when we were talking about Blink. The guy from the Mountain Goats tweeted that his daughter or something, or I can't remember who, like his kid had been singing Blame It on My Juice. And then people tagged us in it or sent it to me. And I thought that it was a misreading of Blink-182's famous single Blame Me on My You. But then other people were pointing out that that's like the hook of Lizzo's Juice, which I honestly think, not to be like, what's a Kardashian, but I honestly don't know if I've heard Lizzo's Juice. I don't know if I've ever heard that song in my life. Like, and I kind of am proud of myself for that, to be honest. But either way.
Get my head.
Oh, that's not that song, yeah, right? Yeah. I think, is that from it?
No, that's Good as Hell is that song.
Oh, okay. Well, anyways, in Juice, she sings Blame It on My Juice. And then that made me think, was Blink referencing Lizzo's Juice when they sang Blame It on My Youth? And I think they must have been, because that, and years later, we're just figuring this out because it's such a poorly executed reference, but that must have been what it was.
What's the difference in time there?
I mean, let's see here. We got time. We got all night.
Okay.
Lizzo.
Okay.
Juice.
I'm going to Blame It on My Youth. You look up Lizzo. Okay. Lizzo, so Blame Juice. It on My Youth. 2019.
September, though. And Lizzo's Juice was released January 4th, 2019. And Blink is like desperate for... Why else would they say Blame It on My Youth? It's not a phrase and it doesn't even connect with the rest of the song. I think they were trying to do like a little hat tip to pop culture and be like, see, we still know what's up. Harambe.
Wow.
Harambe! I think,
but you know, again, this is the difference between you and me is that, like, I thought, and I still will defend the notion of thinking that Harambe stuff was funny up to a point, and then it just wasn't funny.
Right. Yeah. Because when you're just like doing,
but you definitely never thought Harambe was funny.
No, sure I did. Like, I actually did. I did think it was funny too. I did. Okay. I'll admit it. I'm not going to pretend.
I appreciate that. I think that's big of you.
But all I'm saying is I think Blink tried to reference Lizzo to seem relevant and failed so badly that no one noticed.
I wish they had referenced Harambe instead.
Practicing for Mr. Collins' third grand recorder class is the name of this one. And it's also take number 38. So this is going to be good.
Yes. I believe that the track title is Inside Out Take 38 Best.
Really hurts the ears.
Yeah, I got the volume pretty far down here. Oh, yes. Wow. I think Mr. Collins is going to love that.
Isn't that also a Lizzo thing? She plays the recorder or the
flute? She plays the recorder quite famously. She plays the,
is it the flute?
It's the flute, yeah.
The recorder. Oh, my God. I'm having fun. All right, Dionea Spouse, Inside Out. Nice strings.
Okay, the song is good.
I mean, yeah, if there's like a string section. And that sounded like a Johnny Greenwood score, to be honest.
Ooh, yeah.
There's a lot of Radiohead energy in this episode for some reason.
Unexpected amount of Radiohead energy for this episode, for sure.
Okay, this is a great, what's it called again when you combine two words to make them into like...
A portmanteau? A portmanteau?
Portmanteau. Yeah, that's what it is, right?
Portmanteau.
Wait, what's a spoonerism? Yeah, yeah.
That's like Buck Cherry is a spoonerism. I think that's just where you like have a lot of fun with words.
Oh, Eve 6 kind of does remind me of Buck Cherry, to be honest. But this is this band name is a spoonerismento podmatopoeia. Anyways, the band name is Amoeb 6.
Oh, that's good. That's good.
And this person is a true head. Shout out to them. They said, I don't like the song, so I did an insane noise raid version. I voted for real songs I actually like. Back with a real cover next time. Anonymous Nash fucker. Respect. I respect that. Let's go. Let's do this shit. That just feels nice to listen to instead.
Yeah, that was just like a real good vibe.
I love saying
is very funny.
It's almost impossible to say.
I wanted to say it because it seemed like you were having so much fun trying to say it. Amoeb 6.
It is fun to say. Yeah, it's like free jazz to say that wordplay out loud. Okay. Up next is Baby Tyler with Inside Out with a Sad Face. And Baby Tyler wrote, didn't vote for this one, nor was I happy to cover it, but I didn't want to break my streak. Baby Tyler has covered every single song we've done so far. I mean, that is just unbelievable.
Incredible.
So I kind of just wrote a completely different song. Hope y'all enjoy it. So here's Baby Tyler there's a baby's perspective on it.
I would swallow my pride, I would choke on the rhymes, but the lack thereof would leave me empty inside. Swallow my doubt, turn it inside out, find nothing but faith in nothing. What about my tender heart in a blender? Why just spin around to a beautiful oblivion?
Yeah.
I don't know, Baby Tyler. It sounds like you fucking love the song.
I mean, I love that song and I love Inside Out. So I feel like, yeah, confirmed, unfortunately.
No, that was sick, though. And it was very busy. I think it is interesting to see what this discomfort this week has brought out of all of us, other than Sam, who just seems perfectly comfortable at all times. So that's kind of interesting, too.
Listen, again, I just assume I'm supposed to be here.
So this artist's name is the Eve6 guy from Twitter with Inside Out. I've never submitted a cover before, so I'm pretty nervous. Hope you guys like it. So maybe this is the actual Eve6 guy. It would be really funny if it was the actual song. Nope, I think it's Blenders.
I would swallow my pride. I would choke on the rhymes. But the lack thereof would be empty inside. Swallow my pride. Turn it inside. Find nothing but faith in nothing. Want to put my tender heart in my brain. Watch it spin around into a beautiful beauty. I burn like a wicker candle, chalk white and
like
oh so
thin.
I see our time has gotten stale. The tick tock of the clock is painful.
It's weird how much people's instinct with the pod now is to go spoken word. I mean, that's just like kind of scary to me.
in a way.
Oh, right. Like, yeah, that's fair.
We're like 1 year away from becoming just a full-on Fringe Fest thing, which again, I know that's normal to you, but I'm just not right. I'm not at that level yet. I need to be eased into it a little bit.
Exactly. Over the course of the last, like, what would you say, 3 to 4 years? Do you think that's enough for you to be eased into my Fringe Fest lifestyle?
I think so. You freakish Fringe Fest lifestyle. I guess we don't usually do final thoughts. There's only one left, though. But I will say it's kind of been interesting to listen to this. And for me, the idea that someone could maybe listen to it because they're so obsessed with themselves does also make it weird. I don't want to, like, be so mean that – I don't know. I don't want to be so mean, but I still don't like the song at all. But this has been really fun. So I do appreciate the idea of Wildcard Week being so difficult and potentially pushing us out of our comfort zone into that classic – kind of grumpy mode.
Yeah, I mean, like, we kind of insisted that people do something that we wouldn't have chosen. In particular, I felt like we were looking for something that we wouldn't like. The trick here is that I do really like the song, but this definitely forced us to, like, have a different type of conversation. And so, like, I love Wildcard Week, and I love Inside Out by U6.
So here's someone named Forever My Frasier with Inside Out.
I would swallow my pride. The lack thereof would leave me empty inside. I would swallow my doubt and turn it inside out and find nothing, faith in nothing. Want to put my tender heart in a blender. Want to spin around to a
human. This is actually Kelsey Grammer.
I knew that I'm through with you. Burn, burn, the wicker cabinet.
Whoever it is sounds fucking scary.
This year, time has gotten stale.
And that's Inside Out.